Hello everyone, this is class 12 subject chemistry chapter 4 lecture number 6. So in this lecture I will be discussing the preparation of colloids, purification of colloids, properties of colloidal solution, and in properties of colloidal solution I will be discussing colligative property, Tyndall effect and Brownian moment. And in the end of this lecture I will be discussing the questions that I gave you in lecture number 5. So now next we will start with the preparation of colloids. As we have discussed that lyophilic colloids, they does not need any special method for their preparation, whereas lyophobic colloids, they need special method for the preparation. So these are the methods by which we can prepare colloids. So first method is, if we want to prepare arsenic sulfide, so we can prepare the arsenic sulfide sole by dual decomposition method. That is, if we treat this arsenous oxide in presence of H2S, so it will give arsenous sulfide sole. Second is, they can be also prepared by oxidation reaction. If we want to prepare the sulfur sole, so it can be prepared by passing H2S gas through SO2, and here we are getting our sulfur sole. Third is, if we want to prepare the sole of gold, so it can be prepared by reduction method, that is gold chloride, chloride of gold react with formaldehyde in presence of H2O. So here we are getting what? Our gold sole. Fourth is, we can also prepare our colloids by hydrolysis reaction, that is FeCl3, ferric chloride in presence of H2O gives the colloid of FeOH, that is ferric hydroxide. So these are the four methods by which we can prepare our colloids. Next method is, we can also prepare our colloids by electrical disintegration or Bredig's arc method. So this electrical disintegration method, this is used for the preparation of soles of gold, silver and platinum. Now in this method, what we are doing is, we have a container in which we are taking ice, and in another container we are taking metal electrodes. Suppose if we want to prepare the sole of silver, so we are taking these metal electrode and the electric arc is struck between these two metal electrode. So the intense heat that vaporizes the metal and it will come in the dispersion medium. Here we have dispersion medium. So when we pass electric arc between these two metal electrodes, so what will happen, the heat that produced during electric arc, that will vaporize the metal, and this ice, this will condense the metal ions in this dispersion medium, and therefore we are getting our colloids. That is, the metal ions, they will mix in this dispersion medium, and the size of those metal ion in this dispersion medium will become the size of colloids. That is, the size of these particles lie in the range, that is 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. So by this method we can prepare the sole of gold, silver or platinum. So this is Bredig's arc method. In Bredig's arc method, metal electrode is taken and the electric arc is struck between these two metal electrodes. The heat that is produced during this electric arc, that will vaporize the metal and it will come in the dispersion medium. This ice, it will help in the condensing of the metal ions in this dispersion medium, and therefore we can prepare colloids by this method. So the next method for the preparation of colloid is peptidization method. Now what is peptidization? Peptidization is the process of converting a precipitate into colloidal solution by shaking it with dispersion medium in the presence of a small amount of electrolyte. That is, this is also the preparation of colloidal solution. So by this method we can prepare precipitate into colloidal solution by shaking the precipitate in a suitable dispersion medium in the presence of small amount of electrolyte, and this added, the small amount of electrolyte, it is known as peptidizing agent. That is, the added electrolyte is called peptidizing agent. So this method is used to convert freshly prepared precipitate into colloidal solution. In this method we can convert only freshly prepared precipitate into colloidal solution. For example, Suppose these are the freshly prepared precipitate of ferric hydroxide and this FeCl3 is the electrolyte. Now what will happen when we add this electrolyte to this freshly prepared precipitate? What it will do? It will adsorb one of the ion from the electrolyte. That is, in this case, this FeOH3, this will adsorb Fe plus 3 ion on its surface, and therefore this precipitate, as it is bigger in size, so what it will do in the presence of this electrolyte, this bigger precipitate, it will break into smaller particles, and the range of these particles lies between colloidal range, that is between 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer, and here this precipitate is adsorbing Fe plus 3 ions. So that is why the charge on these colloidal particles are positive. So from here we can say that these colloidal particles are positively charged, and by adding this electrolyte, we are converting a bigger size precipitate into a colloidal particle having particle size between 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. So these are the three methods for the preparation of colloid, that is by double decomposition reactions, by disintegration method, and third one is peptidization method. So these are the processes by which we can prepare the colloid. Now in the next topic is purification of colloidal solution. So next is purification of colloidal solution. Now colloidal solution when prepared generally contain excessive amount of electrolytes and some other soluble impurities. While the presence of traces of electrolyte is essential for the stability of colloidal solution, that is, for the stability of colloidal solution we need electrolyte only in a small amount. Therefore, it is necessary to reduce the concentration of these soluble impurities to a requisite minimum. And the process used for reducing the amount of impurities to a requisite minimum is known as purification of colloidal solution. That is, the electrolytes and excessive electrolytes and the impurities, the removal of these impurities and electrolyte, that is done in the purification of colloidal solution. Now we have different methods for the purification of colloidal solution. The first method is dialysis. So dialysis, it is a process of removing a dissolved substance from a colloidal solution by means of diffusion through a suitable membrane. That is, we are removing the electrolyte, excessive electrolyte and impurities by diffusion through a suitable membrane. So here we have a bag in which colloidal particles, that is colloidal solution along with soluble impurities and electrolyte, these are taken in a bag, and the walls of this bag, this is made up of a dialyzing membrane, which is a parchment paper, or we can use a cellophane sheet. So what happen, this dialyzing membrane, this will not allow the colloidal particle to pass through it, whereas the soluble impurities and the electrolyte, the ions of the electrolyte, they can pass through this suitable membrane. Now outside this bag we have water. This is the inlet. From here water is going inside this beaker, and from here water plus crystalloid, that is either electrolytic ions, either ions of the electrolyte or the soluble impurities, they are coming out along with water. Now what happens is when we place this bag in this water, what will happen, these particles, the soluble impurities, they can pass through this membrane as the size of the particles are smaller than the size of the colloidal solution. So this membrane, this will allow the particles of crystalloid and ions of the electrolyte to pass through it. So they will come in the solution and they will come in this water, and from here we can collect water along with crystalloid. And this bag is left with only colloidal particle. So by this method we can remove soluble impurities and electrolyte from colloidal particles, colloidal solution. Now this process is very slow. Now if we apply the electric field in this process, now suppose if this bag contain colloidal solution and only electrolyte. So in that case, if we apply the electric field, so this process becomes fast, and this process is known as electrodialysis. That is, in the presence of electrodialysis, this process can be fastened. That is, again, this is a bag which is filled with colloids plus electrolytes. Now these are the electrodes, or this electric field is applied. So what will happen? Suppose in this bag, let's say for example, NaCl is the electrolyte. So what will happen when we apply the electric field? The Na positive ion, they will move towards cathode, and the Cl negative ion, they will move towards the anode. So by doing this, by applying electric field, this process becomes faster, and in the bag we are left with only colloidal particles. So by this method, we can purify our colloidal solution. Next method is ultrafiltration. So ultrafiltration is the process of separating the colloidal particles from the solvent and the soluble solute present in the colloidal solution by specially prepared filters, which are permeable to all substances except the colloidal particles. Now, as we know that colloidal particles, they can pass through ordinary filter papers because the pores are too large. But if somehow, if we make the size of the pores are so small that they cannot allow the pass of colloidal particles through it. Therefore, in this manner, we can collect our colloidal particles separated from impurities. So here we have a colloidal solution which is 4% solution of nitrocellulose in alcohol and ether. So what we will do, we will dip our filter paper into colloidal solution, and then hardening of that filter paper by dipping in the methanol, that is in formaldehyde, and then if we dry that filter paper, that will become ultra filter paper. Now if we pass the colloidal solution along with impurities through this ultra filter paper, so what it will do, it will not pass the colloidal particles through it, whereas the other soluble impurities, they can pass through filter papers, and we are left with our colloidal particles. After doing this, the colloidal particles left on the ultra filter paper are then stirred with fresh dispersion medium. That is, we can mix the colloidal particles in a suitable dispersion medium to get a pure colloidal solution. So these are the three methods for the purification of colloidal solution, that is dialysis, electrodialysis and ultrafiltration. So next is the properties of colloidal solution. So as we had discussed during the introduction of colloids, the nature, the filtrability and the visibility of colloidal particles. Now here we have some more properties of colloidal solution. So first is colligative property. So colligative property for true solution has higher value than the colloidal solution. What is the meaning of this statement? Here we have true solution and the particle size is less than 1 nanometer. For colloidal solution, the particle size is in between 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. Now colligative properties are those properties which depend on number of particles. Now for example, suppose we have 1 kg. And if we are making true solution and the colloidal solution, so obviously the particle size in true solution is less than 1 nanometer, and in colloidal solution it is in the range of 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. So from here we can say that the number of particles in true solution will be more, because here the size of the particle is less than 1 nanometer, whereas the number of particle in colloidal solution is less than the true solution. However, the size can be bigger. The size is bigger than true solution, but the number for true solution is more as compared to colloidal solution. And as colligative property depends on the number of particles, so here in true solution we have more number of particles. Therefore, colligative property for true solution has higher value than the colloidal solution. Next property for colloidal solution is Tyndall effect. This is the optical property of colloidal solution. Now what is Tyndall effect? Tyndall effect is scattering of light by colloidal particles in a colloidal solution is known as Tyndall effect. For example, in this container we have two solution and in this we have colloidal solution. Now if we pass light, a beam of light through two solution, so the observation is there is no scattering of light, means the light simply pass through the solution, whereas when this light, this beam of light passes through colloidal solution, so what will happen, there is a scattering of light. So in colloidal solution, if we pass a beam of light, so scattering of light is observed, that is the path of the light becomes visible, that is known as Tyndall effect. And this Tyndall effect, this can be observed during the projection of a picture in cinema hall due to scattering of light by dust and smoke particles present there. Now there are two conditions for Tyndall effect, that is Tyndall effect is observed only when the following two conditions are satisfied. So first condition is the diameter of the dispersed particle is not much smaller than the wavelength of the light used. Otherwise what will happen, there the path of the light will not become visible, that is the light will pass through the particles and there will be no scattering of light. So the first condition is the diameter of the dispersed particle is not much smaller than the wavelength of the light used. Next condition is the refractive indices of the dispersed phase and the dispersion medium differ greatly in magnitude, that is there is a difference in refractive index of dispersed phase and dispersion medium, otherwise the path of the light will not be visible, that is scattering of light is not observed if the two conditions are not satisfied. And this Tyndall effect is used to distinguish between colloidal and true solution, that is in case of true solution there will be no scattering of light, whereas if we have colloidal solution there will be scattering of light when we pass a beam of light through colloidal solution. Now in 1903 ultra microscope was made to study the Tyndall effect, and ultra microscope does not render the actual colloidal particles visible but only observe the light scattered by them, that is this ultra microscope, it will observe only the light scattered by the colloidal particles and it does not give any information about the size and shape of the colloidal particle. So this is all about Tyndall effect. Tyndall effect is the scattering of light by the colloidal particles in a colloidal solution. So that is all about Tyndall effect. Next property of colloidal solution is color of the colloidal solution. Now the color of the colloidal solution depends on the wavelength of the light scattered by the dispersed particle and the wavelength of the light, and the wavelength of the light further depends on the size and nature of the particle. That is, for example, if we take finest gold sole which is red in color, and as the size of the particle increases it appears purple and then blue and finally golden. So color of the colloidal solution depends on the wavelength of the light scattered by the dispersed particle, and it also depends on the size and nature of the particles. So next property of colloidal solution is Brownian motion. So when colloidal solution are viewed under a powerful ultra microscope, the colloidal particles appears to be in a state of continuous zigzag motion all over the field of this view. So Brownian motion, it is defined as continuous zigzag movement of colloidal particles in colloidal solution, that is known as Brownian movement. Now this Brownian movement, it depends on the size of the particle, that is smaller the size and lesser the viscosity, that is if the viscosity is less and the particle size is also small, therefore faster is the motion of the particles. So this Brownian movement depends on the size and the viscosity of the medium, that is if the particle size is small, faster will be the movement. This Brownian movement, it is independent of the nature of the colloid, that is it does not depend on the nature of the colloid. And fourth thing is that this Brownian movement, it is responsible for the stability of the sole, that is the stability of colloidal solution is due to Brownian movement. The reason behind this is, as we know that the particles of the dispersed phase, they are in a random motion in dispersion medium. So how they are responsible for the stability of soul. So this can be explained that due to unbalanced bombardment of the particles by the molecules of dispersion medium. Now what happens is the molecule of the dispersion medium, due to their kinetic motion, strike against the colloidal particle, that is with the dispersed phase, from all sides with different forces, and the resultant force causes them to move, and it does not permit the particles to settle down. That is, due to the unbalanced bombardment of the particles by the molecules of dispersion medium, and this is because of Brownian motion. Therefore, this Brownian moment or this Brownian motion, it does not permit the particles to settle down, and that is why this is responsible for the stability of soul. So Brownian motion is continuous zigzag movement of colloidal particles in a colloidal solution is known as Brownian motion. And it depends on the size of the particle. Smaller the size, faster will be the moment. And this moment is also responsible for the stability of the soul. So now I am discussing the questions that I gave you in lecture number 5. So first question is, what are colloidal solutions? How are colloidal solutions classified on the basis of dispersed phase and dispersion medium? So this we had already discussed during our lecture, that on the basis of dispersed phase and dispersion medium, colloids are classified into 8 types. First is when the dispersed phase is solid and the dispersion medium is also solid. That type of colloid is known as solid soul. Second is if the dispersed phase is solid and the dispersion medium is liquid, then we have soul. Third type is when the dispersed phase is solid and dispersion medium is gas, then the type of colloid is aerosol. Next is when we have dispersed phase is liquid and dispersion medium is, when dispersion medium is solid, that is liquid in solid, that type of colloid is known as gel. Liquid in liquid, emulsion. Liquid in gas is aerosol, and gas in solid is solid soul. And the last type is when the dispersed phase is gas and the dispersion medium is liquid, then it is foam. So these are the 8 type of colloid on the basis of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Next question is, what are lyophilic and lyophobic souls? Give an example of each type and why is hydrophobic soul easily coagulated? So first of all, we have the differences between lyophilic and lyophobic colloids. So lyophilic colloids, they are liquid loving, whereas lyophobic colloids, they are liquid hating. And these lyophilic colloids, they can be prepared easily by directly mixing with suitable dispersion medium, whereas lyophobic colloids, they cannot be prepared directly. Third is lyophilic colloids, they are reversible in nature, whereas lyophobic colloids, they are irreversible in nature. Example is starch, gum, gelatin, that they are the example of lyophilic, and metal sulfides, they are the example of lyophobic. Now next question is, why is hydrophobic soul easily coagulated? As we know that charge on colloidal particle is the reason for the stability of colloidal solution. Now what happens is these hydrophobic souls are stable because of presence of charge on the particles. If we remove the charge by adding the electrolyte, then what will happen? These hydrophobic souls, they get easily coagulated. Whereas if we want to coagulate lyophilic soul, then we have to remove charge as well as the solvation factor. That is why hydrophobic souls get easily coagulated on the addition of electrolyte, whereas lyophilic soul or hydrophilic souls, they do not get coagulated on the addition of electrolyte. Next question is, what is the difference between multimolecular and macromolecular colloids? How are associated colloid different from these two type of colloids? The first is multimolecular colloid. Multimolecular colloids are those in which a large number of atoms or small molecules, they form aggregate, and the size of those aggregate lies in the colloidal range, that is in between 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. Whereas in case of macromolecular colloids, large molecules, they will break into smaller molecules. And when we mix those in a suitable dispersion medium, the colloidal solution that is formed, that lies in the range of colloidal particles, that is between 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. And next is, what are associated colloids? Associated colloids are those substances which when dissolved in a medium at low concentration,
they will behave as normal electrolyte, strong electrolyte. But when we increase the concentration, that is at higher concentration, they exhibit colloidal state properties due to the formation of aggregated particles, and that is why they are different from multimolecular and macromolecular colloids. Example of associated colloids is micelle formation, micelles of soaps and detergents. Fourth question is, explain the following term with example. First is alcosol. So when the dispersion medium is alcohol, then that is known as alcosol. Next is hydrosol. When the dispersion medium is water, then this is known as hydrosol. And third is aerosol. So when the dispersion medium is gas, that is known as aerosol. So these are the four questions